state requires you to do it on an annual basis, so we're gonna be doing it annually.
And that one will stay in place until it's replaced, until it's agreed upon, so because of that, like, what it was, that one actually has, requires a negotiation. So we need to.
It can't end until you have another one approved by the state, so it can't have a sunset clause in it. I spent the last 2 or 3 days looking at all the ones that have been approved by the state, to murder or homes like that, so, and the issue is that it carries on, and my concern is that to put a sunset clause in there, we're gonna have to negotiate for it. Which means we may not get it if it's not in, what I'm hearing right now, if it's not in, at the end of September, we run the risk of not having it back by the time of January. Concerned about getting the information in and approved, they're starting to come back from the state, and as I said before, it's almost identical to everybody else's that's out there. Nuance words and those kind of things, so. I still would recommend you approve it, and as we go through it, you'll see it, you probably, likely will see it again, and you'll see the whole document again in a year.
I ran a couple things by the school attorney today, when he says, yeah, so there's a sunset clause in there, so it's not out of line to have something like that. He also said we have to move October 1st, that should be within the same date, it'll be a timeframe for what we say, well, that should be on time.
I just wanna make sure that everybody knows that certainly the January date is a drop dead date in regards to state aid, and it still needs to be inputted into the state and approved. The only ones that are coming back are the ones that have schools that are labeled and marked as schools that need improvement so far. There are, I think 15, 20 of them up there right now, but it was looking at schools that needed it back for, to meet their grant obligations to be supported and approved. So we're still waiting, but that's, as long as everybody clearly understands that you don't have it back, then it's gonna be up to, getting together with the administrators to figure it out.
You say with it, I'd like to see what Percy's prototype plans have already been approved, so maybe.
Well, there is, as far as our plan is concerned, I mean, it's the document that we have, that now has to be taken to the state and approved. What you see in whatever it is, 20 pages or so, ends up being 94 pages from the state. Because each course has to be broken out, at each level of courses has to be broken out. The key, and keep in mind that the items that are there, 90% of the plan is prescribed for us. There was no negotiation or that kind of stuff. It's all state prescribed. It's all just drop down menus that we're pulling off of to use. And also, this plan is identical to the administrative plan, is identical to that of the teachers.
Did John Construction go through this one?
Ultimately, you can take this plan and look at it, and sit. You'll have, cross-referencing it.
The 10 or so that came back from the state, I don't think I would have that person. It looks like a form.
You're just dropping into the drop-down.
So it's not, so to compare what we get, ours isn't in the same format, so I guess I'm.
Yeah, you're realistically not gonna be able to compare until you get the approved plan back from the state. Really, much of it is already prescribed, everything that's there, and everything really seems to be coming back to the state. There are nuances, like spelling out social studies, 7th grade social studies assessment, as opposed to just saying the column is 7th grade, just saying assessment, regionally developed assessment, and spell out that's most of the nuances that are coming back, because I think they're finding that most of the prescribed work is.
It's all prescribed, whatever that number. If everything in the content's all prescribed, it's only a 5-day, then
document that you have that just generally talks about, for example, on a vocal, not using this one, I'm using teachers, as an example, talks about regionally, local or regional development assessment. Some school districts are using third-party assessment. Some are using the local assessment, but you have to tell them that assessment, you're working proceeds, they're working with a group of other schools. So those are the nuances that change in the training is all identical, prescribed training, this is what the training has to happen, this is what the instructors do. They're all the ones that I looked at and all the samples we went through now, so whether it's Pembroke, Williamsville, there, all those, they're really identical. All the thing it is changing, for example, Pembroke is one of the models that I'm looking at right now, is, it's instead of us, with our list assessments, it's listing Genesee Valley Partnership in Education, which are their OCEs. So we're listing Erie 2 OCEs, regionally developed assessment.
When you went through those other plans, did you notice, particularly the appeals section, was there at any point, was there board involvement? When I went through ours, I was concerned that at no point.
Because ultimately there isn't any, because you're going to be, if it ends up in the, where it ends in the 3028 process, where the center is there, so all of the legal counsel that I talked to have pulled out because you don't want to be involved in it, and then also be a final charge later, if you will.
Because it's a contract.
Because it's a contract, correct. Because you're involved in the evaluation, and now you're making some final determinations. So because you have, by law, you have.
Assessing equipment recommended upon the recommendation of superintendent, the Toro GM 455B. Yeah, we'll go back to that. Long tractor and Batwing Boomer attention SFA A006A218 need deemed access and traded in for a replacement long tractor.
Second. Now the tow here is
discussion.
Yes.
Really used to sort of.
I'm sorry?
Or you're really used to a sort of UV?
Well, I looked at it, it's out of UV. And UV uses it primarily for the football field, the practice field, the soccer field. It had one operator and one operator only, and he takes very good care of it. It's not the ground superintendent that is the one operator. He has to ask to use it. So I was pretty impressed, it's well kept. And I talked to the people that sold it to them originally, they're buying a brand new identical unit.
How did you find that?
What happened is our unit broke down, we sent it to Grassland Equipment evaluated it and said to us, you're gonna spend an arm and a leg to repair this thing and it's not worth it. If you wanted to trade it in tomorrow on a new piece of equipment, we'd give you probably $1,000. So you're gonna stick $9,000 into a piece of equipment that you don't know how much longer it's gonna last. So I had them look around, give me all kinds of options, new, used, anything that was out there. And UV approached them and said, hey, we want to upgrade this piece of equipment. And the Grasslands talked about it. They said, look, we understand Eaton's financial situation. They don't have money in the budget. How about if we sell them this unit at the cost of replacing and repairing the 455? And they said they would do that for us. The actual value of the 2004 unit right now, equivalent market value is about $12,000. So we are getting a deal on it.
How much are we paying?
We're going to pay $89.14 and some change, I think it is. Base part of the contract is now complete. That blue part was gone, and all of that brickwork has been replaced, and that's all sealed up. What we're asking you to approve is some additional work on that larger section and another chimney-looking thing that's over the far end above the library. I mean, I've got some pictures, you're welcome to look through them, give you an idea what we're talking about.
Well, the infrastructure, meeting that last week, last week, I was practicing here, and then reviewed and he's gone. It seems valid, the work that he's been having to do, the leaks and the further damage you can cause, but it's his work issues.
By doing it through the contract, the work is the problem.
The one number we don't have at this point is to repair the damage that was below that chimney-looking thing where the blue tarp was. And that's the ceiling going up to the third floor, all right? So I don't have that number, it's been looked at, and we have some issues that we have to deal with this that are special, so. So what you're really looking at is pointing and some of the sandstone that's around there. You'll see when you look at these pictures that it's popped out, and those are all joints that are leaking. You'll see some pictures of the library where the ceiling is stained. Basically, we're trying to go beyond what we had now that we know that there's some money there to really tighten this whole thing up.
Same contract, okay.
Yeah, more estimation.
This is, those are the blue wall there, so how does it work that it wasn't something they did as part of their alternate pieces of work anyways?
We didn't identify it originally because I don't think there was enough money there to do everything.
Right.
That whole concrete cap, that had to be replaced, which would be extremely expensive. So now that we do have money left, the best thing to do is to just spend it and let's tighten everything completely up and take care of some of these other issues. Why it wasn't identified as part of that lifting unit initially, I don't know. I don't know why we didn't look at the entire thing. We just knew we had a problem with that one section that we had water was just pouring.
I'm just trying to figure out procedurally though, because we approved a purchasing order for a different piece of work and the money and the alternative for something different than this. Is that the case?
I don't think so. I don't think it would. I mean, we had a budget that was established for the project. The money's there. I don't think we should be able to spend it because we are. It is infrastructure for the building. Done, particularly with that sandstone originally, created more problems than good. It trapped more of the moisture within and high, which is the reason that you see those things that push up.
Yeah, was that original or was that a repair work?
The sandstone?
Yeah.
The sandstone itself was original, but the repair work was done to it. That's your thing, Paul. That would not have been period correct for 1939.
So it said the sandstone, or did they put that in?
No, the sandstone is going to be put back in. We're going to pull it out and we're going to reset in a better order way.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Very good, thank you.
Justin?
Thank you.
Back to Mr. Contract. I'm not sure, do we ever have the executive session board the last set of terms on this?
No. Who should start off kind of showing us where we're at? Any volunteers? Sure.
The intent is to be highly interactive, so please ask questions. Please just think that you're shaping the world.
Now, if you got your glasses, and if you have your magnifying glass, your jeweler's tool.
Yeah.
me give you a synopsis. You're probably looking at the web page that says ELA, and it has grades 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 ELA. And we're looking at level 4s, comparing level 4s from last year, 2010-11, to just this past year, 2011-2012, and looking for the change, percentage change in our 4s from 2010-11 to 2011-12. And if you're on the page that says ELA, in grade 3, there was 0% change in the level 4s.
Well, let's see if we catch up with the same.
All right.
The literal same page.
You'll see that the top right corner where it says difference.
Okay.
And we're looking at the difference between 4% and 4%.
That's just, you're talking over all three ELA or just grades?
Just level fours. We're talking about the past.
Grade three or
grade
three? All.
Just grade three.
Just grade three, okay.
You go down to level grade four, there's a plus 3%. Grade 6, plus 5%, grade 7, plus 3%, grade 8, minus 6%.
had some discussion last year at this meeting about whether it was, when we talked about the 10% increase, whether it was 10%, if it was our grant master problem, or whether that number means the overall percentage. So this one really reflects the point of last year, the volume numbers listed there for your elevator math and science and grades for the way. All of your regents exams are listed with the total number of kids that took those exams. Percentage that were at level four being mastery on the end of the grade testing, or 85% or higher. Based on last year's scores, there were 883 mastery level scores out of the 2,923 assessments, state assessments that we gave. This year did the same thing, just transferred the numbers in, and I checked these numbers actually three times. We actually gave exactly the same number of assessments this year as we did last year, believe it or not, I can't. And when I first saw the number, I said, it can't possibly, statistically, back and I changed or looked at it and it was, you know, identical. So this year we did have 931 mastery level scores. So if you look at it based on that, last year's 883, an increase in that number 10%, we were shooting for about 88 additional mastery level scores. We did get 48 additional mastery level scores this year, and so it was an increase of 5.4%. So yeah. Depending on which way we want to look at it. And I think overall, based on both bits of information that you had in front of you, I think it basically tells us the same information. That those scores went up by roughly 4% or 1.5%, or I'm sorry, 5%.
It is the number.
Some of the things just to get the one number that changed a little bit really is why we gave a few more testing regions because we gave the ELA twice this year, the comprehensive ELA regions. So that's why that number is a little bit larger than this other than that. It's pretty straightforward. Discussions about the action, which was the one brought up to me originally, that figured out the first time it's provinces. Weightings would have to be weighted outside of the Regents exams because we give 1,600 Regents exams and we give about whatever it is. So we had some discussions with Kristen and amongst ourselves here how we rectify that situation. And we decided that we really need to look at it from a per capita standpoint. Whatever percentage tests were involved in that in relation to the total number of tests, take a portion out of that score. Testing. Well, first of all, the other aspect that we had to think about is we agreed to look at performance index. I know it's sad to say that I know this, but performance index is figured out by you take all your level ones, or you take your level twos, the number of students, you take your level threes, the level of students, the students achieve level three. Total number of level two students, level three students again, three students again, four students again, and again. So you have five numbers there. Your twos, your threes counted twice, your fours counted twice. Add those together. Multiple. That's what means 3 points. And ones don't count at all. And we're fortunate we don't have too many ones. So
Treasure working total points for higher ranking against you.
So you take that total number, you multiply it by 100, and you divide it by the total number of incidents. So exactly. The reason why we decided on the performance index for our conversation last year is because that's since the state testing program went into effect, it's the only constant. They never changed the way that they figured that performance index. It's the only thing that really has not changed.
And then we took that and we put it against the ranking in the counties and then they normalized the tests from if you had a bad year or something goofy or before they drew the line for 3 or 4 that year. Everybody's affected, so it's a ranking against the rest of the schools in the county.
Yes, everybody's affected. So looking at our scores, I have highlighted in yellow there, our 3-8. Performance index in ELA was 160, and we gave 715 tests. And if you look at the 3-8 math, our performance index was 171, and we gave 711 tests. If you look at our Regents exams, our performance index was 105, and we gave 1,279 tests. Take the per capita mindset, we used 42 points out of the ELA 3-8, we used 45 points out of the 3-8 math, we used 87 points out of the Regents to get a combined index of 0.75. We had some discussion while you guys were out there. What does it mean? If you base it here, are the top two 1? Are the next two 2? Depending on how we determine that. So the top two schools that we have listed here, East Aurora and Orchard Park, have a combined index of 186 each, so are they first? What does that mean for Bloomfield and Clarence, who are next at 185?
She wants the Olympics. There's a time, it'll be on a silver.
Former athletic director said they're tied for third. Others not so good. That's what it means. So.
I think if Orchard Park at 185 for 187, I think they're all good.
1-3-3.
Depending on how we count it, I guess I'll break the suspense. Depending on how we count it individually, it's 14. We count it where ties are ties and same score means the same thing for the same, for different people, that's not. So I guess we need to have some discussion on what it, on what it means, honestly, because it.
You mean you should go over more decimal points?
State is not.
Spreadsheet.
That's spreadsheet.
Your state doesn't have this index either, though, so you can go up one decimal place.
No, we could go.
You go one decimal.
I could tell you, yeah, and not see on our base, everything, sorry, if you expand it out one, there's no time. There's no time, so go one, one, so it's truly not.
And that puts us at 14.
14.
Yeah, what for that?
14 is where we moved last year.
Yeah, it's like that.
Any general questions about the kind of rankings to see where you land looking at these numbers? The intent was not to go through all these in detail, all the numbers and so on, we just kind of get a feel for where we're at and figure out where we should be setting goals and. Any?
I do have one question. I have a question on Mr. Chambers, on mathematics. Third one down, plus 33%, can you elaborate on that a little bit? What do you see that came back?
Over the past couple of years, we've had our third grade test scores be slightly disappointing. And we noticed that as RTI program and our classroom instruction programs, it's functioning well, that we noticed big gains. 1 year was in grade six, and it was let down. This year just happened to be in fifth. I think it's because it's a combination of classroom instruction and RTI program. So unfortunately, it puts us at a disadvantage for making enormous gains in the grade levels that after that, because it's moving as hard as possible.
So there's not something, so that's the first time we're getting an RTI program, is during that time period?
The RTI math program.
RTI math.
The RTI math program, last year was the first year that we didn't have an RTI in the late year before. And that the suggestion of the consultant from Iowa University, she said, great, great part, take the pieces. So we took RTI, first, was that like 2 years ago, was it here? And then last year, we had an RTI math program. So I'd say it's, classroom teacher's level one of the RTI intervention program. Classroom teacher, when they see a student is having problems with one of the pieces of math, and math is not all one thing, like some people think it is. A student is having trouble with geometry, don't send them off for remediation. That's the classroom teacher's job to work on that one, that first level. Then, but if the student's problems persist to other areas of mathematics as well, now we have the AIMS, MCAT, and MCOM programs, testing programs that help us sort that out. Then the student goes to RTI level two with a math specialist like Mr. Walker or Mrs. Funk. And if the problems persist, they go to RTI level three with those same teachers, but on smaller groups and more frequency.
We're trying to support consistency in program, delivery of instruction, delivery of resources, and that is the creating of lessons using math so that consistency happens quicker. More, and we want consistency in our programs, and how we start to see the achievement we have. And I think those are really good, and that work, and how they all work.
far as we know, that's what the state is saying.
Well, I think the point Mr. Graff was making is that when you try to chase the evaluation system that a publication like Business First is using, you're never quite sure what it's going to be from year to year. They might factor in your sports program. They might factor in other things that you didn't even know they were going to factor in. But we know that these scores have been consistent in the way community scores have been consistent. Right by it, but it's been consistent since inception.
Taking enough history of medical classes are going through the campus.
They have to have a grade school or other supplemental course with other studies. those that are really real current initiatives they think is. Because one of the things I ask is, how are you getting your staff to put in all those extra meetings and have those conversations about curriculum instruction data? And it's written into the contract with stipends attached to their salaries. Because we often have that conversation of how do you make that work outside of the.
This is part of this, so they have big leaders like your math, and then additional, they have a leader of.
They have three levels, they have instructional leaders, articulation team leaders, and department chair. So one deal with curriculum instruction, one deal with data, one deal with their department.
We have just department chairs.
Yes.
Moving on to the next goal, now just, I was thinking just to highlight where we're at on this, and we decide what we're going to do with the goals in the next session, so nothing too detailed, just like numbers. So for number two, we're now looking at the language program, doing kind of assessment on that.
You have to detail for me, your first way is to go through it. We don't finish all goals, so you can go back to it. I used to test to you for your information, the presentation that the forum leader of the local committee did for us, and they were recommending what they called a funds program. And then I also gave you, there's a lot of questions. Because we have the agenda in June, we did present. So the second one is a presentation from June. We may want to come back to that when we go to goals to share that. We gave you all the what everyone else is doing in the middle of the package. These pages aren't numbered, but it gives you all the load being caught in Erie County and Erie Chukotsky's. So they provided some of that information in regards to economies and stuff for us to look at. But they really came back and shared on the committee if you have anything to share. They really recommended start with the flex piece and start exposing the number of students to more languages. Very well with it.
Yeah, pretty good.
We had a successful town hall meeting in the community, which I noticed. The administration
back and see if we think these are all still valid goals, or we need to change them up, so. But on the list, start talking about, so 180, increase number of master's students, the goal was 10%, we had 5% of the year. We think for the upcoming year, that's still an area we want to focus on, or do we want to change the numbers, take them off the list? Increase the numbers, what do you think?
We had time for 10% for a year.
For one, for this past year, the belief was that we could get, improve the master level by 10% a year, I think that, is that correct?
I think in our discussions that we had, we thought that was going to be a challenge, anyway.
Do you think it's the top 10, or you probably push it?
Should, if you push it to threes, that would help you equally as much as pushing it to three.
Is 10% of the appropriate level of incentive, we had about 5.5. Is 10% appropriate?
I think we're looking overall on ELA, yeah, and regions, I think it is. We saw the ELA tests, the 3 through 8, all through Erie County, all through Western New York, approximated a bell curve, you know, 4 to 5% at the first day nine, 4 to 5%, and the ninth day nine, it was almost like, this is, unless they designed it like a norm reference test, it's almost impossible. But on the other hand, the math, we found more classical, like us, the whole curve was shifted to the right. So is there potential for gain in ELA? If they keep testing the way they did, is there a gain for potential gain in math? Yes, there's quite a bit of gain. In regions?
Always.
That was what it is. So I don't think it's a realistic goal. And if you only accomplish half of your goal,
it's still positive. Don't make your arms head over it. It's not going to be negative.
And then a place for
Exactly. But we're raising that to our own level of answer. We're not right now, you know, this is the difference that are we going up with other businesses or then, but the same issue, we're just saying, are we raising that to ourselves? And we're not saying, here's a great common core program aligned to the standards that we're going to do as a tool. We're really giving them, take everything you can have and pull from it the best you can with all the training we've given you. And be as consistent as you can with your grade level and all the training towards an assessment that we're not hopefully prepared before. With all the nursery training, policies, we're going to keep following them off. So I think we really need to make sure those plot and we have those conversations. The school is pretty good at where teachers are in the classroom for their students.
Based on that, Ron's position, the new group should put together on that, some of your thoughts, I mean, is this a scenario still want to focus on numbers?
I think we have to focus on that, because we all get to.
Yeah, that's the reason, we got to make sure we're doing something different, so do you have the time or do you need to do something? Because the last one we said about that, we don't have the time to ever put behind it, of course, so if that's where we're going, I think it's great.
We have to focus on that, because we have to be better than that area.
Well, you know, I'd say the third grade math assessment is right for dramatic improvement. I'd say the seventh and eighth grade math assessment are right for dramatic improvement. So.
They But I look at level ones, typically A to A, that's typically my students are coming. And our numbers are dropping in that. And if you look at that, there's, I thought I gave my example. Yeah, that the ones who have as many ones, you know, to get mine up to the twos. Even though it's not your three fours.
Careful, so that you're, the enrollment increase,
Our special.
Students in, are they in the meeting? We will have.
Yeah.
And if they're in the meeting, then they're gonna.
It depends, you know what I mean?
Right.
And you have, oh, absolutely, it is needed, at all different levels. It's not just teaching kids how to read.
But is the children in the age changed?
Moving on to one B, does that also seem achievable? Is it the right timeframe? Something you wanna make more present, less present? Top ten?
Top ten, by top ten.
13, 14, 5 in next, but it's up there.
Are there any different things on it?
So close.
Can we change the title?
You feel like the admin team that go into a different bracket?
Yeah, throw the results this year, they look good, get after the following year.
That's true.
Okay, Mary, what do you want, do any different than that one? Do the same. And how about the, how about C? Top five, which is not four. Stick with that one, we need more time, we need a different plan, or what?
Yes, if you go and get a good plan, all these things can be.
And can we talk to Judge to see where we're going with assessments?
Yeah.
Where they, some of this dust settles from all this form, out of the year, maybe much clearer to us.
Do you wanna keep that longer range goal in place, or just stick with the other one? Just B?
Say keep it in place.
Keep it in place.
So you, we're gonna be reviewing these every year anyway, so.
I think we'll be in a better position, actually, hopefully, if we get information back on the state at this point, actually.
And I just think we can make sure we're having a very clear conversation about what it's gonna take to get there.
Right.
And that's really what this is for, is right now, we're kinda having conversations, at least gets us all understanding where we're trying to go. How to get there is not part of the conversation. It's actually the one time of the year to have that, this is the kind of conversation we have. Unless we're not part of budget season, say, which is what you need. And that's good, and we should need to schedule something closer to budget season, just prior to budget season, to talk about, okay, if we wanna get here, what do we need? And then we prioritize against that, so that's what that decision really talks about, so that's. Good. Language program, do we wanna do anything else on that, or take it off the list as a goal, or we can note that for now, or?
I mean, I would like to see the presentation at another meeting, because I mean, there's things, they gather some interesting facts, or, in your act, I mean. If we change the name of it, instead of change the language program, evaluate the program. But, I mean, if you look at the statistics in here.
Now, that's the meeting goal.
Yeah.
The presentation, continue to, you know, support the funds program and our culture to the students, and revisit in a year or two, whatever.
We got into this one last year, and the dialogue was, I think I might not start. What we're looking at, are we offering in the world today the right languages, or the right way to learn languages? So is it the right thing for us, given?
Correct.
Because it's the same program we've had in place since 30 years ago. Almost ever. Is the offering you need, because it's so.
Yeah, you.
I didn't point at you.
But to this presentation, that's.
Right, which looks like this presentation here is trying to address, I mean, if you look at some of the stuff here, CNN online, most widely spoken languages are Chinese, Spanish, English.
Maybe include
So the question, do we need, is this an area we still want to spend some time or emphasis on to see if this is the, what we need to do something differently? Or we saw, or just let that ride?
The money law process was during the goal setting, it was that, you know, might be achieving it earlier than to the school. Because, you know, the kids learn at an earlier age, and once they get to a level that they start taking classes, they're using second ways. If you look at other countries, how they teach language, they start with certificate, and how they learn that one, so they're ready to go. Seventh and eighth is when they first get language.
Seventh and eighth, when they first get.
Higher ends.
Those countries that are teaching English are teaching English. I.e. China, teaching, so that's teaching.
Seventh grade is, kids are really busy. And I think language is really, really close to that.
I know the elementary faculty would say, we're chasing the LA math schools. You moved Schaefer, you moved Band Orchestra out of the school day, so we can get a little more time for science and social studies. Now you want to turn around and put in the language and place it. Show us where that's going to show up on the index scores.
I think it's going to show up in everything.
And the other thing they're probably, they would say is, we know we're coming in, last year with a monetary crunch, we expect in the next 2 or 3 years to be more monetary crunch. You're going to be looking at the lead next time, you justify adding stuff, the lead stuff.
You know, let's make this elective, just like you paying it for the short course, are all elective-based courses.
No, why would we even, retain parents' lives if they have something to do for us?
I think that that's where you're going, though, even this year, which is that you're offering some of that at the school.
I mean, because one of the problems that I had, my son went to, you know, preschool, they offer Spanish. And, you know, once he came out of preschool and director school, there was no Spanish for them. I mean, I even called the high school and asked if they could have a, you know, one of the Spanish students teach, but there was no curriculum, there was no coursework form or anything like that. So, I mean, it was from academic faculty to tutor. So, I mean, it was a tough sell. But, I mean, if there was something offered by the school, I would be more than happy to get my son that leg up, so to speak, and get them language. It's just like, you know, I paid for an instrument for them.
Right. And my home school district has several courses through the community. We have kids in French, we have Spanish, and through the community at Germany. It's a really good program.
What kind of teachers are you?
They do elementary, and then they do mostly elementary because high school we have that. But I can get like a copy of what they do there.
We
Sorry, I got the program set up for 7 minutes. We should do this. He's already doing it. So,
Mr. Sergio, we asked you to work with you. Sorry, you brought up that.
What's that? Some of the presentation.
Yeah, that the Spanish teachers, at least Ms. Keller, replied. Mr. Neal also mentioned that we have to check the schedule for the fall. We've been talking about, if you look down at item C there, the vision for that flex program, an after school Spanish program. And I've been down for grades for 5 and 6. I guess I want to find out what the interest lies. Tuesday, I say Tuesday, Thursdays, because that is when we have late buses, approximately 6 to 8 weeks. 16 sessions via continuing ed. This is Thomas Sewell about this. How much it would be for a minimum of 10 participants per program one day? And then depending on how well it's received, if you offer one or two sections, one for 36, one for 34, I don't know, to see where it goes. And then we also talked with the foreign language teachers thematic days based on some of the, for lack of a better term, high holidays. it's in July. So Mardi Gras Day in February is a big celebration. In Spanish, it's either Day of the Dead, which is right, I know it sounds horrible, but it's right around Halloween or All Saints Day. And we're Cinco de Mayo, but that's right on the cusp of our New York State testing. Yeah, I know that. That goes back to Day of the Dead. Holidays, a lot of schools do things with holidays, all the decorations around Christmas holidays, how the Germans, how the French, how the Spanish celebrate Christmas in their part of the world. And this would be using the upper level foreign language students and their teachers to come to the elementary and provide activities. If the kids wrapped up and move out for them.
For the lesson part, if they agree that they're able to do that, or still check their schedules?
We haven't got past the initial emails that they say they're interested in exploring this matter. We also don't know whether we're going to have it. I think what you're going to find is some people may look at that and say, well, I go to the Boys and Girls Club for X number of dollars for all the school year. And yes, you have learned a foreign language. They learned it, I don't know.
Okay, it was foreign.
It was foreign.
See how well they
learned.
Sometimes these statements are made about students who are more motivated, parents who are more motivated, who are easier, more cooperative students, but not all class. determined.